going to discuss my multimodal project over the young adult novel Pride by E.B. Zoboi to analyze and show you how I turned this novel on its head. This story strongly alludes to Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice and takes the reader on a journey with Zuri as the protagonist and the social obstacles she must overcome in order to resist the initially perceived single story and be at peace with the growing changes around her, such as her new rich neighbors that live across the street from her, as well as the gentrification of her neighborhood. I chose this novel to further analyze because I fell in love with Austen's Pride and Prejudice and loved even more this modern take of it with its emphasis on social problems such as cultural identity, wealth, and class stereotypes. I also liked how it initially seems like it would be a single story from Zuri's point of view about outsiders from her neighborhood moving in across the street from her. But once she gets to know and somewhat relate to them, it becomes a counter story about economic and social statuses in a class-driven society. I chose to visually dissect these issues and plot points from the novel by the thematic repetition of windows that seem to not only peer into someone's home and life, but as well as a metaphorical emphasis about what happens behind closed doors in this novel. This helps me to divide up the different social class aspects that indicate this novel is in many ways a counter story. In the beginning of this novel, not everything is as it seems, and many times Zuri and Darius peer at each other from the windows of their homes with predisposed notions of who the other character is without truly getting to know each other. This, also emphasized by the usage of travel and transportation, expand on the distance that both characters must cross in order to meet in the middle. In the end, they see each other for as they truly are and not by their social and economic class or stereotype stigmas and resist those single-story facets through open communication. For the first section on the left, I drew a picture of Zuri's laptop and phone to emphasize the use of communication and sometimes lack of it throughout the novel, as well as a crystal ball to symbolize the mystic energy that Zuri's landlord, Madrina, often spoke about in her and how her insight and intuition helped navigate Zuri and the rest of her neighborhood throughout their problems. For example, one of the single stories that Zuri first encounters and eventually resists is the idea behind Madrina's faith in spirits and the supernatural that helped guide her and give advice to those around her. Zuri says, "Madrina has a crystal ball on that table as well as tarot cards. Small bones from God knows what, coins from God knows where, shells, stones, pieces of folded paper, and a small collection of cigars, but that's all for show. Most times, she just sits there pulling from a plain old cigarette and talking to her clients about any and everything." This shows Zuri's initial lack of understanding and naivety towards single stories of this nature. Another symbol pictured here to help further my point is the use of the phone and laptop. Oftentimes during this novel, texting for communication, as well as other electronic devices such as Zuri's laptop, help her convey thoughts and feelings that may otherwise not have been expressed. Oftentimes, it may seem easier for Zuri and Darius to communicate this way, as seen during the time that Zuri talks with Warren on her apartment stoop and Darius tells her about what happened to his sister over text in order to warn her about Warren. This leads to a development and change of feelings between characters and leads Zuri to resist the initial single story she perceived about Darius and Warren in the end. Next, on the right square of the window, you can see a picture of my attempt at drawing a lobster and package of fries. These are to emphasize and indicate the economic wealth and social class gap between Zuri and Darius. For example, when Zuri goes to visit Howard University, she ends up catching a ride back home with Darius in his car, and they stop at his grandmother's house for dinner where they eat expensive food such as lobster. Darius's sister asks Zuri if she likes to eat lobster, and she says, "Sure, I say, but it's a lie. I've been to Red Lobster but never had the lobster because it's the most expensive thing on the menu, and with seven of us going out to eat for a graduation or a big birthday, no one is selfish enough to order lobster." During the dinner, Zuri also feels uncomfortable with the obvious show of economic and class disparity between Darius and his grandmother and herself. Afterward, on the drive back home to their neighborhood, they stop at a fast food restaurant where they share some fries and both feel noticeably more comfortable in the less tense environment due to the casual nature of it. Zuri says, "I pause for a little bit to watch him open up the bags and pull out his food. He eats his fries as if they're the most expensive thing in the world. He catches me looking at him and motions for me to come over. For the first time during this whole trip, I'm able to sit back and take in the wide blue-orange sky and warm summer air. There are no tall buildings around or sirens or loud music and voices, just the soothing sound of speeding cars in the distance." Another example for how the food portrayed in this novel indicated an initially wide social gap between the characters is demonstrated during the dinner party that the Darcy family hosts at their new house. Zuri's family bring over traditional Haitian food, while the Darcy family had hors d'oeuvres and fancier food items served. This also makes Zuri feel uncomfortable, paired with the differences between her family's clothing choices and the Darcys. But these disparities point Zuri to initially believe in the single story about economic and class disparity between her family and the Darcy family. But as more communication between her and Darius is given, she resists the single story and turns it into a counter story, and coming to a mutual understanding with Darius that not all differences among them are bad or too different to overcome. Next, below my first square of electronic devices, I have pictured a police siren and ambulance to represent the differences in social classes in this novel due to certain run-in situations that occurred. I found it interesting how for Zuri, Darius, and Carrie, law enforcement interaction is identified very differently. For Zuri, when she hears a police siren or sees an ambulance in her neighborhood, she feels more comfortable and less on edge, whereas when she was at Carrie's party with Darius, she told Darius to leave out the back so that he would not get in trouble with the cops. This is modeled by the interaction and small conversation they have when the cops come to talk with Carrie at the door. Zuri says, "My stomach sinks when I hear sirens coming down the block. It's not the same as hearing sirens in my hood. In this part of Brooklyn, with its giant oak trees and multi-million dollar brownstones, police and ambulance sirens mean that something really did go down." This social class disparity leads Zuri to believe that she and Darius come from two different planets, as she calls it. But earlier in this novel, she contradicts this belief with her own opinion about how even if Darius acts differently and has more money than some of the people in her neighborhood, the cops will still all treat them the same, thus resisting the single story that just because Darius is richer than her doesn't mean he can get out of the same kinds of situations due to his race. Zuri says, "Just so you know, in this hood, you're just like everybody else. The cops and all these white people will take one good look at you and think you're from the Hope Gardens Projects, no matter how many tight khaki shorts or grandpa's shoes you wear." Finally, to emphasize how the economic and social disparity between the Darcy family and Zuri's is not just a single story, I drew the image of Zuri's apartment next to the big house that Darius moved into across from her. In this novel, it talks a lot about gentrification in Zuri's neighborhood and how the wealthy family moved in next door to her. Oftentimes, the description of the inside of the Darcy house and all the things they had inside compared to Zuri's family's apartment were a stark contrast in social and economic classes. Towards the end of the novel, Zuri resists the single story about her rich neighbors and the idea that where you live and the neighborhood you stay in are what define your home life and future, much alike to the novel The Outsiders. Zuri says, "If I get in, then I'll know that people like me have a say in how our lives turn out. Even if we're thrown away by people with more money, we can always climb our way out of the messiness and the brokenness of our lives. Because the thing about sharp corners is, the right turns can bring you back home." Zuri further resists these single stories exhibited throughout the novel at the end when she reconciles with Darius about all the misguided prejudices they initially had about each other before openly communicating and listening to the other person's thoughts. Zuri says, "We're not going to just throw away the past as if it meant nothing. See, that's what happens to whole neighborhoods. We built something. It was messy, but we're not going to throw it away." This project has offered me a more distinctive and insightful look into the novel by connecting the social and economic class distinguishing markers between the characters, as well as finding symbols and quotes to guide my analysis of this. I did find it a little challenging to draw said markers because sometimes the social and economic facets were more conceptual than visually distinct, but overall was a thoroughly enjoyable project to work on and highly educational for me to reread and further think and expand upon the materials I found within this text. Thank you for watching.